Good morning, everyone. Merry Christmas.
Christmas.
You know, I was really kind of surprised. Apparently, nobody here heard who's having to preach today. But you came. If you did, you came anyway. Thank you. Just a few announcements, real quick. We got something really special here in a couple seconds. We got the little ones. You know, we had the choir sing last week, and the kids sing with the choir, but now this morning I think we got the little ones going to give us a little bit of special music here in a couple seconds. Just a few announcements. No evening service tonight or next week. We will have the Christmas Eve service. Interestingly enough, we'll do that on Christmas Eve. I think that's on Thursday. Is that Thursday?
It is.
This Thursday, right?
Yes.
Thursday. Don't say Wednesday. Who said Wednesday? Terry, was that you? Okay, Thursday's Christmas Eve. Now that I got everybody confused, I'm going to be here on Thursday. So, Thursday, Christmas Eve, that's at 5 o'clock. Please come, and I think we'll be having communion that night as well. Let's see. January 10th. Now, this is way out there in the future. Pastor will begin a new member class, another new member class, on January 10th in the Sunday school hour. So if you're interested in joining the church or know someone that would be interested in joining the church, would like to know more about the church, even if you've been here a long time, and would just like to know more about the church, the history of the church, there is a tear out on the bulletin. Just use that and just let the pastor know in there that you want to attend his class. If you have any more questions, you can see him when he gets back. Caroline will be taking directory pictures next Sunday. And so if you want your picture taken or retaken for the church directory, then see Caroline next Sunday after the morning service. That is it for announcements, except Arnold, you mentioned something. Christmas cards. Christmas cards. Pick up your Christmas cards. They're in the lobby of the fellowship hall. So after the service, please make sure you go pick up your stack of Christmas cards over there. You just never know how much money you're leaving on the table if you're not over there picking up your Christmas cards. Just kidding. All right. Yes, please pick those up. They are in the lobby of the fellowship hall. At this time, we have a very, very special group going to come sing to us. So come on.
They would all like to wave hi to everybody so they can get that out of their system. Hold your bell.
Christmas bell, Christmas bell, Christmas on Christmas Day. Tell each happy boy and girl a sentence on today. Christmas bell, Christmas bell, ring on Christmas Day.
Thank you.
stand and sing some Christmas songs this morning. Now, I was told by Eileen I need to make sure I warn everybody. We're going to do these songs just a little bit different this morning because the First Noel and We Three Kings, you're familiar with these songs, but they've got a lot of verses. The First Noel has 6 verses, and We Three Kings has 5 verses. But if you read through them, if you leave out any of the verses, you leave out part of the Christmas story, because they tell a story. So what we're going to do is we're going to sing through all the verses, and we'll do one chorus at the end of each song. How about that? All right, so let's do it. The First Noel, 265.
Thank you. pray. Father, especially at this time of year, when we think about and sing about and celebrate the birth of your Son, who brought salvation to us all, the greatest gift to mankind. Father, we have no appropriate words to thank you enough for this. All we can do is appropriate it and be graceful, be grateful. Father, be with us now as we continue to worship you, and keep us ever in mind of your Son's sacrifice for us. Always in Christ's name, amen.
Orchestra. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 2. And let's stand as we read the first 12 verses. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. If you hadn't guessed from the song service, we're going to be talking about the wise men today. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search diligently for the young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star, which they saw in the east, went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, and frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this passage. We thank you for the reason for the season, as we say, Lord. We just pray for this time as we open your word, as we study it. Lord, may all that we hear today be understood, and those things that we learn be taken and applied today, Lord. And Lord, just guide and direct through this time, and guide and direct the hearing of the word and the preaching of the word, Lord. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. Please be seated. You know, like I said, it should be no surprise. I wonder what I'm talking about if you didn't see the outline. But, you know, the one advantage you have when you get to stand up here in the pulpit doing the song service and the message is you get to make things really kind of coordinate a little bit. And the songs that we happen to sing are some of my favorites, even though they're long and they have 6 verses and 5 verses. But they are some of my favorites. And Matthew chapter 2 is one of my favorite parts of the Christmas story, the wise men. And understanding what that story is about, I think, is important, because there's a lot of things that are misconstrued about the wise men, especially in popular culture. I will note that I always joke about us being here for another, you know, an hour and a half, so settle in. Today that might be true. I will remind folks, like I did my Sunday school class, that you know, America is the only place where we actually watch our clocks when we're sitting in church, and I understand why. But today's not that day, so 1 o'clock or so. Hopefully you didn't put the roast on a timer today. No, just kidding. No, I'm going to do my best to stay within the lines. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. The wise men. Oh, I can't help myself. I just get off on rabbit trails. Rick comes in this morning and says, there's no such thing as a bad short sermon. Who were the wise guys? I mean, who were the wise men? How many were there? Were they actually kings? Did they really ride camels? Why did they come to Bethlehem? When did they go to Bethlehem? Now, many would find the answers to these questions rather simple. We could probably all snap off answers to those pretty quick, knowing what we know. But unfortunately, what we have, most of the ideas that we have about this fascinating group of people from our culture, from our own understanding and upbringing, we draw most of that from Christmas cards. We draw that from the writers of Hallmark Christmas cards more than we actually draw from theologians and historians. Now, there's many absurd traditions and guesses respecting these visitors to the Lord's birthplace. Many of these have found their way into popular belief and into Christian art, such as this one. They were said to be kings, and that they were three in number. They were said to be representatives of the three sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and those three families. And one of those is pictured as an Ethiopian. Their names are given as Gaspar, Balthazar, and Melchior. Now, you've probably heard those names, right? Amazingly enough, in the 12th century, apparently, a bishop by the name of Renaud of Cologne apparently found their skeletons and skulls. And today, believe it or not, they are on exhibit in a priceless casket in a great cathedral in Europe, and they number in the number three, because that's tradition, and that's the skeletons that they say belong to these wise men. Now, frankly, the only thing that we actually know about these specific wise men in Matthew chapter 2 is what it says in Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. What it does tell us is, there came wise men from the east. That's it. We don't know their names, their number, their mode of transportation, nothing. Everything you see on that picture is something that we don't know about the wise men. You know, as we put the pieces together, though, we look at these wise men, these magi, we do have some very fascinating history. So what we do know about these magi, we know in verse 2, or in verse 1 of chapter 2, that these wise men came from the east. Now, the word wise man here is actually not really a translatable word. It's a proper noun. Much as you would see the name of Christ or the name of the apostles, they're not translatable, they are proper nouns. This is the word magi. It's simply a tribal name, a designation of a hereditary priesthood. It's a hereditary priesthood tribe from among the people known as the Medes. And if you remember who the Medes are, they are half of the Medo-Persian Empire that followed the Babylonian Empire. Now, the Medes were a large group of people composed of various tribes, amongst whom was the Magi tribe, a hereditary priesthood, much as the Levites are in the Old Testament, and a hereditary priesthood amongst the Israelites and Jews. They rose by virtue of their wisdom, by virtue of some occultic powers in some cases, and by virtue of their astrological and astronomical ability that they had. They rose to places of advisors to the kings, to the courts of Babylon, Persia, Media. They were very high ranking across the entire East and across multiple world empires, including the Babylonians and Persians. So high ranking, in fact, that no king ever took the throne of the Persian or Parthian Empire that wasn't trained in their laws. The laws of the Medes and the Persians. You remember that term? The law of the Medes and the Persians. You know, that was the law that not even Darius in Daniel could change. That was the law that not even Ahasuerus in Esther could change, even though they were king. These were the lawmakers, the Magi, very influential to the point of being the official kingmakers of the great empires to the east of Israel. It was their business to recognize, their business to coronate kings. They had been in the courts of kings for years, centuries, really. They were the official kingmakers. Now, imagine, how significant is it then that these official Eastern kingmakers find their way to the little small town of Bethlehem to honor this very one who was born, the Lord Jesus Christ, to honor him as king, these kingmakers. So where did these kingmakers get the information about this Christ child? Now remember, We look back in our history and biblical history and history 580 years plus, give or take, before Christ is born, Israel is taken into captivity, into Babylon. When they were there, they told these people, they told the Babylonians, they told the Medes, they told the Persians, all of these folks that are mixed into these empires, they told them about a king that was going to be born. In fact, there was one of those Jews who rose to a place of great prominence. Do you remember his name? Daniel. Daniel. So this begs the question, is there any other information that we have on the Magi besides Matthew 2, verse 1? Well, as a matter of fact, there is. We look in Jeremiah 39, verses 3 and 13, and we're introduced to a man by the name of Nergal-Sharezer. And he is named as the chief Magi, an influential person in the Babylonian Empire. In Esther 1:13, we actually have an indication that the royal bench of judges was all chosen from the Magi. These were powerful people. These were powerful people. They were the lawmakers, they were the kingmakers, and they were the entire judiciary. You know, if you look in American politics, they covered all three bases. They were everything. So we look back in Daniel, in Daniel 2:10, it says, the Chaldeans answered before the king and said, there is not a man on the earth that can reveal the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, lord, nor ruler that asked such things of any magi or astrologer or Chaldean. These were people in the court of Nebuchadnezzar. In Daniel 4, if we go a little farther in Daniel, we again see the Magi in chapter 4 there, verse 7. Then came in the Magi, the astrologers, the Chaldeans, the soothsayers, and I told the dream to them, but they didn't make known unto me its interpretation. Then we skip over to verse 9, and it says, O Belteshazzar, master of the magicians. Now here we meet the master of the Magi, Belteshazzar, who just so happens to also be Daniel. That is his Babylonian name. And in verse 11 of chapter 5 in Daniel, we are reminded again that Daniel became the chief of the Magi. Now there can be little doubt that this great prophet of God, Daniel, told the Magi that he was chief over the Magi, and they told them about the coming king. So the Magi were ready for this because probably of Daniel. They were looking. And through those next five centuries, a remnant of those Magi waited for this great individual to arrive on the scene. Now let's fast forward back five centuries to the time of Jesus. So look at me with me again at Matthew 2. Time has gone on, century after century, until Jesus is to be born. Now in some marvelous way, God has managed to maintain some true God-seeking magi. Most may have already been corrupted, and certainly many were corrupted, including two in particular that are actually mentioned in the book of Acts. But there were still some magi, high-ranking kingmakers in the great empire of the East, who were still waiting for Daniel's great hope to be fulfilled. So let's set the stage here. Politically speaking, Rome is scared. They're scared of this Eastern Empire, the Parthian Empire, the old Persian Empire. Now remember, Rome has stretched out its tentacles across the entire world as they knew it, but they never really felt secure on their edges, especially on the eastern edge of their empire where the Parthian Empire came up against them. They had become violent enemies. They struggled, they fought over and over, battle after battle, war after war against the Parthians. The great empire in the west, Rome, the great empire in the east, the Parthians, would come together and fight. And guess where they would fight? Israel. That seemed to be the battleground for where these two enemies fought each other. Now Rome was afraid of them. And if you look at verse 3 of Matthew 2, it says, when Herod the king had heard these things, he was what? troubled. He was troubled. Now, when Herod heard that these magi, these Oriental Parthian kingmakers had arrived in Jerusalem, he was troubled. He was rattled. Now, at the time of Christ in the Eastern Empire, there was this ruling body of the Parthians. They were called the Megasthenes. It was totally composed of magi, whose duty it was to have absolute choice for the selection of a king. They were the kingmakers. These kingmakers, though, had some real problems there just before the time of Christ with the king that they had currently had. They wanted to fight Rome. They wanted to take off Rome. They wanted to knock them off. But their king, Phraates IV, was weak, not up to the task. So they deposed him, which is a nice way of saying they assassinated the king, and began a search for a new king. This is going on during the time of Herod, during the time of the birth of Christ. The Parthians are in search for a new king of the East, a new king of the Eastern Empire to lead them against Rome and defeat Rome. So when they arrived in Jerusalem, Herod knew what was going on. They were the kingmakers, and when they wandered around town saying, "Where is the new king of the Jews? Do you know where the new king of the Jews is?" It's no wonder Herod was troubled. A new king to displace him. A new king to fight against the Romans, who he was aligned with. And a war that would inevitably take place right in his backyard. Which finally brings us to Matthew 2, 1 through 12. So with this as the stage, we look at these five acts in this drama that are played out in these 12 verses. The arrival, the agitation, the acting, the adoration, and the avoidance. So let's look at them. Verses 1 and 2. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." Now obviously we have the arrival right here. Shortly after Jesus' birth, the Magi arrive in Jerusalem. Now there are things we want to note in the very beginning in verse 1. First of all, the phrase, "in Bethlehem." In Bethlehem of Judea. Now, Bethlehem is a quiet little hamlet, little tiny town, approximately 5 or 6 miles south of Jerusalem. It was once called Ephrathah, and it's so designated in Micah 5:2. Now, those that have been to Israel and been to Jerusalem, you recognize Jerusalem as you're driving up to it. It sits way up on top on a high plateau, and you can see it all the way over to the coast, along the Mediterranean coast. Some 2,000 feet above the valley floor. And down to the south, towards that valley floor, sits this little tiny town of Bethlehem. This little village sits between two ridges in a saddle, a cradle, if you will, between those two ridges. The area is composed of a soft gray limestone. The houses of Bethlehem are built all over the slopes of those ridges. Very frequently beneath the houses, because the limestone was not that hard and because there were some natural indentations in that soft limestone in the mountain, people would build out a hollowed cave, which they would use for the stable. It's very likely that it was such a hollow cave in which our Lord Jesus was born. You'll also notice that there is no doubt some time that has passed from the time of Christ's birth to the time of the arrival of the wise men. There is a time gap. Maybe a good period of months have already occurred. Jesus being born probably sometime toward the end of the year, and then Herod dying sometime in the first half of the following year. We know that he died, or at least we believe that he died somewhere around the end of March or the beginning of April in a lunar eclipse during the year 4 BC. And this may be as many as 4 to 6 months after the birth of Christ. It tells us down in verse 11 that when they came to him, he was in a house. When they were come into the house, they saw the young child. So we also see here that Christ is no longer in the manger. He's no longer in the stable. He's in a house. And it's very likely that Joseph and Mary, in Luke 2:22, had already been to the temple for purification. If we look back at Leviticus chapter 12, and we see the requirement for when a Jewish lady has a baby, there was a certain period of time where she had to go to the temple for a purification ceremony to offer a sacrifice. Joseph and Mary offered turtle doves. This was the offering of somebody who is in abject poverty. So what does that have to do with the timing? Well, if the wise men had already arrived with their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, then the gift probably would not have been the gift of someone who was in abject poverty. It would have been the gift of someone who could afford a lamb sacrifice. Now, the next thing, all that to say that Christ was already probably a few months old, older than 40 days old at least. Now, the next point, Herod, in the days of Herod the king. Now, we don't need to spend a lot of time talking about Herod. We have a lot of knowledge already about this person. He was an accomplished politician. He had a massive building projects, which we're aware of, projects that are rivaled only by Solomon himself. He was appointed to be king of the Jews by the Romans, so he was very adept at the politics and getting himself appointed king. He was willing to do anything to keep that title and position. This made him a vicious, brutal, and utterly paranoid and petty tyrant. This man killed his own brother-in-law, and then he killed his sister. And interestingly enough, knowing that he was near death, he rounded up all the important people of Jerusalem, all the well-liked, wealthy people of Jerusalem. He imprisoned them and ordered them to be executed on the day of his death. Why? So that there would actually be mourning in Jerusalem when he died. They wouldn't be mourning for him, but they would be mourning for somebody. And he wanted people to be mourning on the day of his death. And then, of course, we all know his capabilities when he killed all the children of Bethlehem later on in chapter 2 here. The next thing we see in this passage is the word behold. Behold. Now Matthew is calling attention to something with this word. Whenever you say the word behold, well, I think it's time to behold. So what is Matthew saying? He's not saying, oh yeah, and by the way, there were these people called Magi, they showed up. No. What he is saying is, wow! Woo! Look at this! This is huge. I'm getting my Bob voice going. This is a big deal. Behold, the Magi came. This was unexpected. This was shocking. This was amazing. This was unprecedented. These people don't just show up. They don't, you know, take it out on the road. You know, it's just not one of those things that the Magi do. They show up. They're there for a reason. And Matthew says, behold, the Magi came. Now, historians tell us that when they arrived, it wasn't just three fellows coming into town on some camels, like we see on Christmas cards. I looked for pictures that had something more historically accurate. They don't exist, by the way. And if you send out cards that look like that, I still love those. This was a group of people that probably, these official kingmakers, they rode into town, probably had on these high peaked conical hats that stuck way up in the air. They had big flaps coming down from the side of those hats that stretched probably all the way to their ankles. Hats all the way down to their ankles. They had wild flowing robes. They were riding Persian steeds. And historians tell us that they were accompanied probably by a group of crack Parthian Persian commandos. This was an entourage. These were important people. They didn't just venture out into the desert alone on a trip across over to Judea. This was a big group of people. This was a formidable group. This was an important group of people, and they were big news. Then we see the star. So what is this star? What is the nature of the star? Some suggestions are, get ready for this, it is simply a star. Some say it was a star that had gone nova or supernova. In other words, a star that exploded and became brilliantly bright in the night sky. Some say it is the planet Jupiter, the king of planets. Or some say it's a convergence of Jupiter and Saturn, which is even brighter. Which, by the way, we have going on right now down here in the southwest sky. And so people are saying, the star of Bethlehem has returned. Well, as many of you have probably seen in the video, Star of Bethlehem. I mean, how many have seen that video, Star of Bethlehem? I've even showed it in our Sunday school class. It's interesting. It's hypothesized that this triple conjunction of Jupiter, the king planet, and Regulus, the king star, this triple conjunction where Jupiter goes around this star, that was the Star of Bethlehem. Others say it's a comet. Others say it's a meteor, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Folks, it was none of those things. Many of these things assume that the wise men followed this star all the way across the desert. So it had to be some astral event that happened, some natural event that happened. They saw it in the east, and then it went before them as they went from Jerusalem to Bethlehem, and they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. Folks, this star made two special appearances to the wise men, to the Magi. Once in the east, which motivated these men to leave and start heading to Judea. And then, when they left Jerusalem to go to Bethlehem, it led them those 5 miles and landed right over the top of the house, the exact location in Bethlehem where Christ was. So what was this star? Now, the star in the Greek is auster. This word can mean star, it can mean heavenly body. It can even refer in scripture to people, to angels. So when you look at the word in Hebrew, the word for that is kakav. Now, this is the word used in Numbers 24, where it says that there shall come forth a star out of Jacob. This is a prophecy of the coming Messiah, Numbers 24. Matthew 2 is the fulfillment of that prophecy. The Hebrew word here means a shining, a blazing. When we look through Scripture, we see all through it the blazing, shining light of the glory of God. It appears to his people in specific and various ways, in various purposes. It appears to Moses from the burning bush and on Mount Sinai. It appears in the tabernacle. It appears in the temple. It manifests as the pillar of cloud and fire to blind the Egyptians as well as lead the Israelites. It appears to Peter, James, and John on the Mount of Transfiguration. It appears to John on the Isle of Patmos. And in Luke, it appears to the shepherds as the glory of God that shone round about them. The glory of God is a blazing light. It is the blazing Shekinah, the glory of God. Folks, the star is simply this. It is the miraculous blazing light of the Shekinah glory of God that appeared to these God-seeking magi as a sign to head to Judea, and it then reappeared to them to show them the very house where Jesus stayed. And now we see why they came, to worship him. They had seen the sign of the king, the glory of God, and now they were come to worship him. To worship, literally proskune, it means to stoop and kiss. It was a word that spoke about the way you paid homage to a monarch. You stooped down, you kissed his foot. The word proskune finally came to mean any internal attitude of adoration or worship to someone greater than yourself. They came to worship. Now, interestingly, when the New Testament uses this word, it always is used as something either truly or supposedly divine. It is a word that is only fit for deity, for God. The Magi not only recognized the king, beyond that, they came to worship more than a king. They came to worship the anointed one that God had sent, the one fulfilling the Old Testament prophecies, none other than the supernatural Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God incarnate. So we see the arrival now in verses 3 through 6. We see the agitation. When Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled. We talked about this a little bit. In other words, he was extremely worried. He was paranoid. If there's anything Herod is remembered for, it's his paranoia. He was cruel, he was vicious, and all Jerusalem is troubled with him. Why? Well, because they were not only worried about being the battleground for a new Parthian-Roman war, they also knew what this guy was capable of. He proved it with the killing of the children of Bethlehem. He was troubled. They were troubled. This is implying a state of panic in Jerusalem as these kingmakers arrive. Now in verse 4, it says, when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. Now, isn't that interesting? He demanded of them where who would be born? Christ. Even Herod himself knew that this was more than just a human king. This was the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. He made that connection in his mind. He was ruling in a day when the hope of the coming of David's greater son was in the hearts and on the minds and on the lips of the entire world. He knew this meant the Messiah, the Christ. Next, we see that he called for the help of the chief priests and scribes. We see this group several times throughout Matthew's gospel. They are the opposers of Christ and his disciples. And here they are called upon to give counsel to King Herod. First of all, let's look at these chief priests. Now, in short, we could talk for an hour about just these two groups. In short, this is not talking about the high priests, the Annas and Caiaphas that we see in the gospels. Nor was it talking about the worker class of priests that ministered daily in the temple. This was that middle group, that class between the two. This is the aristocracy of the priesthood, the Sanhedrin in particular. Also the captain of the temple guard, the temple treasurer, and many others. The temple overseers, the aristocracy. In other words, these were the self-important academics and ruling class of the Levitical priesthood. And alongside them, the scribes. These were members of the other 11 tribes that were also scholars, theologians, the general know-it-alls. From these groups, we see them divided later on in the New Testament as the Pharisees and Sadducees. So Herod gathers them all together with this simple question, where? Now, this place, as we see later on in the Gospels, is actually a place of common knowledge amongst both theologians and the people, a place that is well known of where the Messiah would originate. And Herod should have known it. It appears that here in this verse, they answer him almost immediately with the verse, like I said, we're all familiar with, Micah 5:2, in Bethlehem of Judea. They quote the scripture to him. But I want you to note something here. It's interesting that this group of scholars weren't interested in the significance of the events that were transpiring in Bethlehem. They were only interested in the facts of what the scripture said. They're indifferent, the chief priests and scribes. But by the way, they didn't stay indifferent long. In fact, they became hateful, venomous, plotting murderers. And the whole time, from the indifference of Matthew 2 to the plots and murders at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, all the while, this group of people had the full knowledge of the prophecies being fulfilled by Jesus Christ. And they still rejected him. So we have the arrival, the agitation. Quickly, let's look at the acting. Verse 7. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, this time he thought he ought to have a private meeting with these men. If you had another public meeting with these guys, everybody would know exactly what was going on and that something was up. So we had a private meeting, and he inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. So we had where and now when. This is the act. This guy, what a hypocrite. What a phony this Herod is. He has a sly plan in the works. And we see his true intent and goal come to fruition later in the chapter. His goal is to find out how old this child might be so that he could kill him. Verse 8, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, now after he'd gotten the information, go and search diligently for the young child, and when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. So here Herod compounds the ruse, claiming that he wishes to worship him. But instead of desiring to fall at his feet, he desires to kill him. Take his life. What a fool. This man is a fool. He would kill the Savior. The only Savior. So the arrival, the agitation, the acting, and now the adoration. The journey is complete for the Magi in verse 9. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star, which they saw, past tense, in the east, went before them from Jerusalem to Bethlehem, till it came and stood over where the young child was. There it is, the blazing, the sign, the glory of God, the Shekinah, the star has returned, this time to guide them directly to the very location where the Christ child was. And what is their reaction? Verse 10, when they saw the star, I love this part, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. There was the Shekinah of God again, and they knew they were on the right track. They had been given the sign, the Shekinah, to go to Judea to see the King of the Jews. And again, here is this appearance of God to tell them, you're on the right track. Right here, this is where you need to go. There would be no need to rejoice if they'd been watching this event up in the sky, this astral event, since leaving Persia. This reappearance of the sign given by God was cause for rejoicing with exceeding great joy. Then we get to verse 11. When they were come into the house, and so, well, by this time, remember we talked about it, they're in a house, not a stable. They saw the young child with Mary. And by the way, whenever Mary is mentioned in this story, whether it's in verse 11 here or 13, 14, 20, 21, the babe is mentioned first. This story, folks, is not about the wise men. It's not about Joseph. It's not about Herod. It's not about Mary. This story is about, wholly and completely about, the child. So when they came in, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped. Who'd they worship? Not her, not him, not them. The child. They fell on their knees and worshiped him. And worship belongs to one and one only. God and God alone, Jesus Christ, his son. To none other, for none other is worthy. So these wise men worshiped. How did they worship? In giving. Now, pastor always kids around, somehow, you know, somebody always says, oh, so it turned into a sermon about giving. Well, yeah, it did. This is about giving. This is about worship. Giving. What a great way to worship. What a great way to worship. We see giving as a form of worship throughout the Bible, and even in the Old Testament law and the sacrificial system. Giving is an integral part. When we give our tithes, when we give our offerings here on Sunday mornings, it's a part of worship. It is a part of, we call this the worship service. That doesn't begin or end with music. All right? This entire service is about worship, the offering and tithes included. The wise men here worship with giving, a concrete, tangible expression of praise. What did they give? We sang about it several times this morning. Gold, frankincense, myrrh, valuable gifts. Gold, that's the easy one, right? We know what gold is. It was valuable then. It's valuable now. It's a sign of wealth. It's a sign of power. Kings have it in abundance. When tribute was being paid to kings, it was paid in gold. Gold was a gift for a king. Then we see frankincense. This was simply a pure incense. It was expensive. It gave off a very pleasing scent. It was this incense that was offered on the altar of incense in the holy place in front of the veil on the altar of incense before the ark of God. The scent, it says, was a pleasing aroma in the nostrils of God. It typified our prayers to God. This is the gift to God. Frankincense speaks of deity. In fact, incense was always offered to God because it belonged to God. Ezekiel 16:18 says, "It's my incense." That is God talking in Ezekiel. My incense. And so they come. And by the gold, they say he's a king. By the incense, they say he is God. And with myrrh, myrrh, an expensive perfume. Myrrh is the gift for a man, for a mortal. It's a perfume to make life just a little less odorous, to make burial a little less repulsive. Myrrh was the gift for a mortal man, and he was a man. In fact, myrrh was especially the gift for one who would die. And this child was born to die. He was mortal, and it was clear from the beginning. And so they came with gold, a gift for a king. Frankincense, a gift for God. And myrrh, a gift for a man. And he was all of these things. So finally, after the arrival, the agitation, the acting, the adoration, finally in verse 12, the avoidance. God wanted them to escape the paranoia and the wrath of Herod, to take the message of the king back to their people in Persia, the message of this new one, the Messiah, the anointed one. And so they were warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod to tell him about the baby. Then they departed to their own country another way. And so God here, we see, cares for his people, the Magi, as God cares for the Savior in protecting him from Herod. So let me close with this. In this passage, we see three reactions to the Christ. The one who is king, the one who is God, and the one who is man. The first is the Herod group. The antagonistic, the bitter, the hating, the paranoid, the delusional even, about Christ, against Christ. Then we see the chief priests and the scribes. This group, they're uncommitted, they're indifferent, but inevitably they oppose. Then we see the final group, the adoring worshipers, the Magi. What do you bring to the Christ child? Is it bitterness? Is it hate? Is it indifference? Or are you lined up to worship? Do you have the gifts of worship fit for the one who is King, God, and man? And that is the lesson of the wise men. Christmas and the celebration of the birth of Christ is about one thing: bringing us to our knees before the God, man, King in worship. That is the attitude we should have in this season as we celebrate. Come and worship. Come and worship. Worship Christ, the newborn King. Let's close in prayer. Father, we just thank you for coming to this earth, for coming to this earth and fulfillment of prophecy and in coming to save us, Lord. And without you, we have no hope. Lord, we offer you our worship. Thank you for coming to die on the cross and be our Savior, Lord. Lord, just may we remember that during this Christmas season, that we are here to worship and adore. Lord, just be with us now as we go home for this day, for the rest of this week, as we have our Christmas Eve service, and remember that we are to worship and adore Christ, our Savior and Lord. In Christ's name we ask this. Amen. Let's stand and let's just be dismissed with those very words I closed with. Come and worship, come and worship. Let's sing that first verse of O Come All Ye Faithful.
O come all ye faithful.